Maybe to start, I think it's absolutely important to understand that the question of democracy is the core questions, the core question of all politics of our times. I find this absolutely important to realize that. This doesn't mean that democracy is more important than the climate or social questions or economic questions or even more important than the unconditional basic income. It is not, but democracy is the basis for all these other questions. If you do not have a real working democracy, then we, the citizens, are just the objects of decisions taken by others, and mostly decisions taken by the interest of power, of money, of financial interest, and so on, but not in the interest of the citizens. So therefore, the question of democracy is the core question for all other political questions. And that's the reason why I, besides engaging for a basic income, I concentrate in my work very much on the question of democracy, and in this time of European democracy. You probably know that before that I'm the founder of Mehr Demokratie in Germany. We have changed Germany a lot. We have introduced direct democracy in Germany on the municipal and regional level in all German Länder. We work on introducing it on the national level too. I now built up an organization called Democracy International that works on the same questions on the transnational and international level, because for me, the more we have globalization, the more we have international, transnational decisions, the question becomes crucial: are we able to create democracy or to safeguard democracy also beyond nation states? If not, then the globalization, the Europeanization, internationalization of decision making means the end of democracy. And we have a lot of tendencies towards that, like international trade agreements, where, for example, some people sitting behind closed doors think that they can decide or take decisions that limit the sovereignty of the citizens, of parliaments, of democracy, of politics. They think that investors, so companies, have more right than parliaments. So if you change a law on the environment, social law in a country, then they have the right to plea against that, to go to court against that, and to get compensation for that, which is a completely crazy idea, and shows that the question of democracy more and more becomes the crucial question in our time, where more and more people think that they can establish global governance without the people. So what I work on now in the European Parliament and also outside the Parliament is the question of how can we establish more democracy on the transnational level. The first thing that I invented together with a couple of friends of mine in Mehr Demokratie and in the Initiative and Referendum Institute was the European Citizen Initiative. So we asked ourselves 10 years ago, what can we introduce for citizens to have more say in European politics, to have a foot in the door at least? We had many more ideas for binding instruments like referenda too, but we introduced them to the convention for the European Constitution that later then was the Lisbon Treaty in 2002 and 2003. And the European Citizen Initiative was the one that we could bring through, that we could achieve. And so we have the European Citizen Initiative now. I then became rapporteur in the European Parliament for that. This only would be a very long story, the report about ECI, since you need to know that European politics is always on bargaining and always on compromises. First in the Parliament and then between Parliament, Commission and Council. So I managed to to adopt a very strong position in Parliament for a citizen-friendly, easy, practical framework for the ECI. We got huge support from all political groups in the Parliament on that, but this was not the end of the game. Then we had to negotiate with the Council and the Commission and the Council, especially the Council, so the heads of state, which in my eyes in itself is strange, that the heads of the executive power in member states play the most important European legislator. This is completely against the idea of European democracy, of Montesquieu and all that. And I think for the future of the European Union, this will become a crucial question. I think that in all questions where Europe has the competence to decide, it needs to be the parliament or the citizens that have the last say, and not the governments. This is wrong. So this is just by the way. So, but we managed to negotiate on the citizen initiative, but a lot of issues that nowadays create problems with the citizen initiative were brought in by the member states. I would like to give only one example. My position and the position that was backed by the whole parliament was, this is an European citizen initiative. And this means we need one European framework, one European format for citizens to subscribe, to sign. So you sign, that was our proposal, with name, address, and if it's on paper, signature. If it's online, you need name, address, date, and place of birth. This is because in some member states, like Greece, Romania, they cannot check if it's only name and address. They need to have the date and place of birth. So we said, okay, this is it, and this is the same for all European citizens. If that would have been adopted by the Council, it would be easy to sign an ECI. But the Council came up with different ideas from every member state. So Germany said, oh, if you want to sign, you need to show or to fill in the number of your passport or ID card. The French came with driving license, fishery license, and hunting license. So it became a complete mess, completely crazy. And this was the position of the Council, that in every member state you need to fulfill different requirements. So I said, this is impossible. I negotiated with the Council to change that. The Council negotiator understood it, but he said, I am bound by the member states. So I met with the representatives of the member states. I take Germany as an example. I talked for 2.5 hours with a German representative. Then he said, okay, Mr. Hefner, you convinced me. I will go for this simple European format. But 2 weeks later, he called me and said, I cannot do anything because I have advice from Berlin to stick to the old position. So I said, who is Berlin? And he said, it's the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So I called the minister, Mr. Westerwelle, and I told him, you have to change your position. This is absolutely undemocratic and un-European. And he said, okay, I'll see what I can do. Some weeks later, the answer from the foreign ministry was that it was not them to decide. It was the Ministry of Judiciary. So I called the Minister of Judiciary in Germany, Frau Leutheusser-Schnarrenberger. I asked her. I met with her in Berlin. I could convince her. She said, okay, I'm convinced we will change the position. Some weeks later, I learned it was not the Ministry of Justice. It was the Ministry for Interior. And in the Ministry for Interior, it was a young man, a nice guy, who replaced the person in charge because she was in maternal leave. So he was on a new post and had to decide something important, and he thought, I don't want to make a mistake, so let's take the hurdles as high as possible. And he said, in Germany, we need this and that. So then I could convince them to change the position. At the same time, I already had approached the German data protection supervisor, and I had forced him or convinced him to write a letter to the German government that their position is against German data protection law, because you're not allowed to collect more information than you really need in context with the expression of a political position of a person. So then Germany changed, but it's impossible to do this with all member states. I could achieve this with 14 member states, but not with all of them. I tell you this also because this is a lesson that we need to learn about European democracy. If you read in a newspaper or if you hear Germany says this, France says this, Portugal says this, who decided that? It was never us. It's some civil servants mostly who decided that and who think they are Germany. So this is a strange format of democracy and we have to change it. European citizens is a first step approach towards that. You know that we have seen the first successful citizen initiatives, but still it is a very complicated regulation and framework. And so we worked in the last month very much on how to reform it. We will start the reformation procedure in 2015. I will not be member of parliament then because I decided to be member of parliament only for one term. I always did it that way. I was member of the German Bundestag always for one term, three times, but 4 years in parliament, 4 years out, 4 years in, because I want to be, I see my basis in the civil society, in the NGOs I work with, in the NGOs I built up, and I want to be, you know, a player that makes the links and tries to achieve things in parliament, but I do not see this as my profession. I don't want to be a professional politician. So I will leave parliament, but I talked with a lot of colleagues that will work on that, and I achieved that the parliament made a study where I had the responsibility for on what needs to be changed in the European Citizen Initiative. And I can promise you all important points are in there. So, for example, the unified European simple format, but also many other issues that will help to improve the citizen initiative. But still, then we'll have a problem because with the citizen initiative, according to the Lisbon Treaty, we can only invite the Commission to take action. We cannot urge the Commission, we cannot bind the Commission. Therefore, we need more. The European Citizen Initiative, in my eyes, is only the first step towards more European participatory and direct democracy. We need not only a representative democracy where you vote once and then you are a mere spectator for 5 years. We need to have instruments for citizens to intervene whenever they want. And we need to have instruments for citizens also to decide if they are not happy with the decisions taken in parliament. Then we need a huge debate on the UBI. I think the debate is everything. We need to create the debate throughout Europe. And only if we had this debate, then we will have a chance to get a majority also in political votes. But if you have instruments, for example, a European-wide referendum, then this instrument will trigger a debate because once people know, okay, there's a referendum and on 1st of November I will have to vote, then they will start to inform themselves, will start to discuss. So direct democracy referenda always brings more information, more discussion, and especially more discussion on issues, not only on parties or politicians. It brings more engagement, many more people engage politically, and it brings new issues, new themes on the agenda, and it leads to more integration in and identification with the common good. We have created societies where every person learns to go for his or her own interests. What we haven't organized is how can we find what is in the common interest? We need debates for that. We need instruments for that where citizens debate what is good for the whole of us. So therefore we need this. And therefore, one thing that we are organizing now, that I'm organizing together with the new organization that I founded, Democracy International, is we organize a campaign for a new European convention, because in Article 48 of the Lisbon Treaty, it is said that whenever you want to change the treaty, you need to have a convention. And we need important treaty changes for more democracy, but also for more solidarity in Europe for many purposes. So we call for a new convention and we call for a referendum, a European referendum, in the end of this convention process. So that from one day we can say Europe, it's not their Europe, it's not up there in Brussels, it's not them. Europe, that's us. We are Europe. Europe is a Europe not of governments, It's a Europe of the citizens. That's my vision. That's my aim. We will not achieve this in one day, but you need to have a long-term aim in order to take the steps to achieve that. And I think our aim, since you probably know, I'm working for an unconditional basic income since 34 years now. I started the first initiative in Germany 34 years ago on this issue. I think the two issues completely belong together. The question of enabling every citizen to live as an independent and free human being on the basis of an unconditional basic income, and at the same time to be a sovereign in the society, to have the right to decide on the very important basic questions of how do we want to develop our society and which rules should apply for all of us. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.